Okay, and we will resume business. Can I just say it is more than a bit disappointing that when it's follow-on business, so many members were absent at the start of this debate, requiring an unpredicted suspension of business. But we are ready to move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 12991 in the name of Christine Graham on Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill at stage one. Members wishing to participate should press the request to speak buttons now as soon as possible. And I call on Christine Graham to speak to and move the motion around 8 minutes. Ms Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I apologise as one of the culprits. I welcome the debate today and the progress it represents. For members who came into Parliament just this session, I've been working with a wide range of organisations on the policy within the Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill for the last 7 years, seems longer. I genuinely welcome the valuable work of the lead committee, and I really do, and the constructive series of recommendations it has produced as a result of its scrutiny of the bill. It did give me food for thought and did its job well. I'll focus on a number of these recommendations later in this debate, but first I want to talk about why this bill is needed. Many moons ago, there was a song called "How Much Is That Doggy in the Window? The One with the Waggly Tail. I Do Hope That Doggy's for Sale." Not singing it. Long since the sale of puppies in pet shop windows has been banned, but has it? Windows have changed to Microsoft Windows and the internet. And the understandable impulse to acquire a puppy or a young dog has remained. And indeed, if anything, the pandemic increased that demand for reasons, quite frankly, I fully understand. The second preliminary point I would to make is that this proposed legislation is not to punish, not to blame, but to educate. I think we would agree that there's a surge in the level of dog ownership across Scotland, combined with a lack of an informed approach from the public to buying a dog. And with criminals always alert to demand and profitable opportunities, a rise in unscrupulous breeding through, for example, puppy factory farming, where puppies and the breeding bitches are kept in appalling conditions, then marketed as expensive, desirable commodities, unsocialised and often very sick. Purchasers, unaware of the reality behind the cute online images, pay thousands, and the conveyor belt of misery continues. They may even have buy a puppy to, quote, save it, close quotes. They may save that puppy, but not the next or the next. Despite worthy endeavours by the government and animal welfare agencies, illegal breeding, casual purchase, heart over head, continues. Supply, particularly unscrupulous supply. I consider that might best be attacked by addressing demand. So, as I say, some 6 years or more ago, I had a similar bill ready for the off when the pandemic put everything on hold for 2 years. The pandemic only emphasised to me the need for my bill. Referencing the illegal trade, extracts of evidence from key stakeholders who support my bill demonstrate the scale of the issue. The SSPCA estimates the illegal puppy trade is worth £13 million in Scotland. Animal Trust highlights the huge rise in problems arising from buying a dog where it cannot be properly looked after, including abandonment rates continuing to rise, and with 96% of rehoming centres reporting an increase in behavioural issues. Battersea found only 5 to 10% of puppies across the UK are coming from licensed breeders who should ensure healthy puppies and appropriate new owners. So up to 95% of puppies are bought from unlicensed sellers. Calls to the SSPCA helpline on giving up pets has quadrupled, with costs, vet care and inappropriate living conditions cited as common reasons. A recent survey found only 29% of people considered cost when they got their pet. Dogs are the most frequently abandoned animal, and rehoming centres are experiencing incredible financial pressures as a result. Evidence from the Dogs Trust is amongst the weight of support for the bill received by the committee. Its submission describes the purpose of the bill as, quote, educating and providing prospective dog owners with the tools to purchase or rehome a dog more responsibly and to identify and avoid any unscrupulous breeding practices, close quotes. Yes, I will.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the member for giving way. She makes a very good case as to why legislation is necessary. My understanding is that her bill would include a code, and I wonder if she could say why she feels it's necessary for the detail of that code to be unusually on the bill. I don't say that as a criticism of the bill, but just why she feels it needs to be on the face of the bill to have so much information about the code.
Christine Graham.
Never offend you would offend me, Mr. Dr. Allen. No, I will come to that. The evidence of the committee reflects the value of educating and changing the behaviours of the buyer, improving that, and as a result, changing the demand and buying practices of the public. It would have a positive impact, preventing so many of the notable problems I have just highlighted and of which I'm sure members in the Chamber are aware. Reduced demand affects supply. One of the key questions that came up during stage one evidence taking that the committee had deliberated upon is why do we need a separate new code when there is an existing code on dog ownership? The code in the bill serves a very different purpose to the existing code. It will have a very different appearance given its distinct purpose, and it applies to a different group of people, and it has a new certificate and associated process attached to it. The current code, which relates to someone already having a dog, runs to 28 pages with additional website links. I might call it, if I was being naughty, quotes, War and Peace, close quotes, but I'm not naughty. Though I wonder how many dog owners even know it exists, let alone read it. The code under this bill applies to people considering acquiring a dog, and it would do three key things. It would redirect people from owning a dog if they realise they can't afford one, help people take more time to identify the right breed for them, and help people assess the situation the puppy is being sold in so they see warning signs that something is amiss. I'm aware of the time, so I'll have to move on. The briefest consideration of these questions will cause pause for thought, no pun intended, for those buying a puppy in particular through online sales. It will cause lots of other valuable pauses for thought about the cost, the breed, questioning why they can't see the mother with the puppy, and so on. As will asking them to sign the certificate and confirm they understand the need to retain it and they understand and have read the code. I want to emphasise the importance of the certificate under my bill. This seeks to ensure anyone buying a dog will reflect on those questions and others, prompting them to educate themselves further before making a choice. This certificate is based on a process followed in France, where as of 2022, a certificate is required when you buy a dog or any other number of animals. Both my certificate and the French certificate will also require the provider to sign the certificate and the acquirers so that both know what they are doing. And I'd like to thank in particular Mike Flynn, who brought this to my attention. I shall move very quickly and touch on other matters, because I've only got 8 minutes, I believe.
And I can give you a little bit of extra time.
Thank you very much. In relation to part two, which seeks to establish a register of unlicensed litters, I remain passionately committed to the policy behind this proposal. At present, given the lack of any licensing regime for those who do not register as licensed breeders, because there's legislation for that, there is no way of tracing where each puppy sold in Scotland comes from, enabling unscrupulous breeders to continue to sell large numbers of puppies out with the licence system. So the intention behind Part 2 is to improve traceability, so any dog being sold or transferred in Scotland needs to be on a searchable database. This would enable the public to take informed decisions when sourcing a puppy, and it would aid enforcement, making puppies sold out with either regime, including the illegal puppy trade, far easier to identify. However, I am realistic about the difficult financial environment we're operating in. I know local authorities are under pressure, immense resource pressures. I firmly believe, though, a thoroughly implemented register brought in at a time where resources are less sparse would have been beneficial. But I have conceded, as the committee knows at stage one evidence, that it may be better to actively pursue another approach to improving traceability. By that, I mean taking forward the long-standing need to make progress with the microchipping regime. A solution to traceability that does not require further legislation would give the ability to trace all dogs through the microchipping system, and I'll say more about that later. Progress in this area is long overdue. Given the benefits this bill would deliver and the scale of the urgency of the problem, I welcome comments from the Minister today on plans to engage with DEFRA on microchipping and to really get to work on the solution moving. On the basis this valuable work will happen, I am therefore content to support the Scottish Government's proposal to remove part two of my bill. But with that caveat, I want to see progress on a portal for microchipping. So I very much look forward to hearing the contributions in this debate. I'm sure they'll be robust, and will respond to as many of them as I can in my closing remarks. And I thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Graham. I now call on Finlay Carson to speak on behalf of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee. Mr Carson, around 7 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak today on behalf of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee, reflecting on our Stage 1 inquiry and report on Christine Graham's Members' Bill, the Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill. To set some background to our inquiry, we issued a call for written views, to which we received 95 responses from individuals and 23 responses from stakeholder organisations. We then explored the issues raised with a roundtable of animal welfare organisations and the Law Society of Scotland, and then the then Minister for Energy and Environment and Christine Graham, and we published a report on the 5th of March. Christine Graham has already spoken passionately about her reasons for introducing this bill and the objectives it seeks to achieve. And Christine Graham told the committee that, and I quote, "I want the public to understand that they are the custodians and are policing the welfare of Scotland's puppies and young dogs, and that targeting demand will change the nature of supply." We heard evidence from animal welfare organisations that the number of dogs bred by irresponsible breeders continues to grow, resulting in some people buying dogs which present behavioural and health issues, and increasing numbers of requests to home dogs as the result of that. These animal welfare organisations supported the general principles of the bill. The Kennel Club told us that the existing legislation targeted irresponsible breeders, and it's not enforced adequately. Bad or rogue breeders, or those imported illegally bred dogs, can, and I quote, pretty much get away with it. The Scottish SPCA also outlined how entrepreneurial rogue breeders can be what they can do to get around measures designed to tackle irresponsible breeding. And finally, the Minister agreed that it was increasingly difficult for those...
Russell Finlay.
Thanks for taking the intervention. Excuse my ignorance in this matter, but there is a significant involvement of organised crime in dog breeding in Scotland. I just wonder if the committee, during its inquiries, managed to ascertain the extent of that.
Finlay Carson.
Thanks for the intervention. We don't have any specifics about it. There was certainly everybody around the committee understood that it was organised crime gangs, whatever, that could play a big part in the trafficking of these dogs, you know, particularly in my constituency of Galloway and West Dumfries, where we see dogs coming through Cairn Ryan. So finally, the Minister agreed that it was increasingly difficult for those wanting to buy a dog to know whether a breeder was reputable. And on that basis of evidence, the committee agreed that some further measures are needed to focus on the demand rather than the supply of puppies and dogs. To the specifics of the bill in Part 1, which seeks to introduce a code of practice for the acquisition of a dog, the main issues relating to this provision is that the Scottish Government already has the power to introduce this code of practice, and in fact already has introduced a code of practice on the welfare of dogs, albeit this focuses on good practice around owning a dog rather than the acquisition of a dog. Views were mixed on whether a new standalone code was required or whether the existing code should be amended. Animal welfare organisations supported a single amended code, and the Dog Trust told us that would make perfect sense, and the Scottish SPCA argued that having a single code would make it easier to prove, in the event of any formal proceedings, that someone had known where to look for guidance. Christine Graham, however, felt that including the provision of the bill in the existing code would mean that they would get lost in translation or perhaps War and Peace, and it would be diluted and wouldn't be as effective. And the Minister told us that it was time for the existing code to be refreshed, but it would not be drawn on whether the Scottish Government agreed with a separate standalone code or whether any refresh to the existing code would mean incorporating Christine Graham's proposals. It's fair to say that this was the one aspect of the bill which the committee had less consensus, but the majority of members agreed that the proposed code should be a standalone, concise and accessible code. Our other recommendations in relation to Part 1 were to amend the bill to remove the Section 2 questions, which the proposed code would require prospective dog owners to ask when acquiring a dog. The committee felt it would be more appropriate to have the flexibility to change the questions in the future, to amend the provision that the bill should come into effect within 6 months of royal assent. Well, we felt that would not leave sufficient time for an effective consultation, and that the bill should apply to all dogs, not just pets. We were persuaded by Battersea Cat and Dog Home, for example, who argued that working dogs should share the same level of protection as pet dogs, and that the code should be subject to parliamentary scrutiny in the same way that the existing code is subject to parliamentary scrutiny. We agreed with the proposed certification to confirm parties have adhered to the code, whilst concerns were raised about the lack of enforcement provisions, and we agreed with the advisory approach, which seeks to educate rather than penalise dog owners, and that the publicity of this code would be fundamental to its success. And whilst we noted the Minister's view that the expected costs would be sufficient, we also noted a general view that publicity campaigns rarely fulfil their reach. Part 2 seeks to introduce a registration scheme for puppy litters where a breeding licence is not already required. Animal welfare organisations supported this proposal, arguing it would improve traceability and address the defects involved with microchipping. Concerns were expressed, however, about requiring the litter itself rather than the breeder to register, and the Minister expressed concerns that it, in itself, registration would not protect welfare and could provide a false legitimacy to unscrupulous breeders. Concerns were also raised about the cost on local authority to implementing the register, and although Part 2 would not be implemented until a time when local authorities had more money, the committee felt that without a clear timetable, the register was not a workable solution. The Minister was open that the Scottish Government would seek to amend the bill to remove this provision, and the committee agreed that an alternative approach would be a more effective and quicker way of improving traceability for puppies and dogs. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Carson. And I call on the Minister around 6 minutes, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, as someone who spent a lifetime from the age of 8 when I got my very first Labrador pup called Pepper, until very recently, so just shy of 50 years, I've had dogs in my life as pets and as working colleagues helping me to gather sheep and cattle for the vast majority of my life. So as a dog person, I'm fully aware of the important role they play in our individual lives, in our communities and their contribution to society, and just how important it is that we continue to take their welfare and lifelong well-being seriously. But despite their popularity as much-loved family pets, we know that not all dogs are sold, purchased or treated responsibly. They can often be acquired impulsively with a lifelong commitment not fully considered or enough thought as to where the puppy has been acquired from. And having sold a number of pups from working colleagues over the years, I am acutely aware of the responsibility of sellers or transferers of dogs in ensuring that they are placed in appropriate homes who understand the needs of the dog, the breed temperament, the exercise requirements and the nature and potential problems associated with the dog that has been transferred. Responsible dog breeders and sellers take these responsibilities very seriously indeed. And in fact, my wife and I have actually refused to sell people pups in the past because we couldn't satisfy ourselves that they were fully aware of what they were taking on. Unfortunately, that's not always the case, and there are far too many unscrupulous sellers of pups from puppy farms where welfare is the last consideration and profit is king. There's increasingly sophisticated ways unscrupulous criminals behind the trade can fraudulently pass themselves off as legitimate home breeders. They take advantage of the public demand for pups of particular breeds, often supplying pups bred in poor conditions in other countries that can develop serious health and behavioural problems because of poor conditions that they are bred and kept. This can lead to a heartbreaking situation for new owners whose decisions when buying the dog are quite often emotive. So I'd like to acknowledge the hard work of the Scottish SPCA and other agencies across the UK who continue to collaborate to combat the low welfare puppy trade by sharing information and taking enforcement action against the criminals involved. And the Scottish Government supports this work and continues to make significant improvements to legislation on dog breeding and pet sales in recent years, as well as funding the campaigns to increase public awareness of risks. The Government is also committed to setting the highest standards of animal welfare. We do not want...
Billy Carson.
I appreciate the Minister taking an intervention, and I do welcome the fact that Christine Graham has brought this bill forward. But right through the evidence, we heard from the Minister, Gillian Martin, at the time that she agreed with almost everything that Christine Graham's bill achieved to do. However, she did acknowledge that the Government already have the powers to deliver most of the recommendations or the policies that this bill would bring into force. So why has the Scottish Government not addressed this before, and why is it taking a member's bill for you to do the job and step up to the mark and look after the welfare of dogs?
Minister.
I can't answer the latter part of that question as why something hasn't been done in the past, but what I can say is that the Government is taking this commitment very seriously, and the code that Christine Graham is talking about is different from the one that currently exists. So the Scottish Government supports the work and continues to make significant improvements. We're committed to setting the highest standards of animal welfare. We want to do everything within our power to educate breeders, sellers, owners and prospective owners on how to meet a dog's needs and to make the right choices when acquiring a dog. There is always more that can be done in ensuring that existing legislation around breeding and sales is enforced, and we continue to engage regularly with local authorities and other bodies around us. However, because of the continuing strong demand for pups in Scotland, there will unfortunately always be an incentive for unscrupulous breeders and sellers to operate illegally. To tackle this, it is so important that we focus on the demand for the pups to inform and encourage how to acquire a responsible and safe, responsible acquiring of a pup. There is already a significant volume of advice online to educate buyers. Previous Scottish Government public awareness campaigns such as Buy a Puppy Safely gave advice on how to acquire a pup responsibly and how to recognise the signs of the illegal puppy trade. This was accompanied by a hard-hitting social media messaging, and the campaigns had significant impact in reaching their target audience and led to an increase in puppy investigations and puppies seized by the Scottish SPCA. It is important such awareness campaigns are sustained in the longer term to achieve significant lasting changes in buying behaviour and to address any growing trends. And the Government wants to encourage the public to take more responsibility when considering taking on a dog and how they acquire it responsibly, which is why I support the intentions behind this bill. Now, I commend my colleague Christine Graham for her commitment and her tenacity in bringing the welfare of dogs to the attention of the Parliament. She has striven repeatedly to highlight unresolved and unsatisfactory issues around the selling, transferring and acquiring of dogs in Scotland, and I wish to express my admiration and thanks to her for the constructive approach to the development of the bill. I also thank the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee for its detailed scrutiny of the bill, the proposals and the preparation of the Stage 1 report, which has made many helpful recommendations. Part 1 of the bill proposed the introduction of a new code of practice for the acquiring and transfer of pups and dogs to include questions for a prospective owner and a certificate confirming they have considered these questions. Part 2 proposed the introduction of a register of litters. In terms of the committee's recommendations and working with Ms Graham on the bill's amendments, the Scottish Government agrees with allowing longer than 6 months after a royal assent for the code to be made to come into effect. The code to apply to all dogs, not only dogs kept as pets, and I have to say, during our evidence session, I had concerns myself about the working dogs bit, but I am convinced now that including all dogs is the right course to take. Yes, I will.
Christine Graham.
To take an intervention. I think I've given good considerations. And like the Minister, I appreciate there are good people, farmers, police, guide dogs to the blind. I mean, these are working dogs that are specially and they're not casually purchased or acquired. But I think, given my consideration, I appreciate there could be a loophole in that somebody can say that this is a pet, this is a working dog and not a pet, and in fact it is a pet. So I'll give consideration seriously if the Government are putting forward any amendments to make it all dogs.
Minister.
Thank Christine Graham for that intervention. The attention should detail and ensure sections of the bill are consistent with the Animal Welfare Licence of Activities Involving Animals Scotland Regulations 2021 on points such as seeing the dog with its mother, making the requirements for confirming the dog's age and responsibility of both the acquirer and the person selling or giving the dog away, and the requirement for a certificate to be part of a new code of practice rather than a separate requirement in the wording of the bill, and finally, the removal of Part 2 of the bill. I would also like to acknowledge in this debate the Scottish Government does have the powers to create a new code of practice or guidance under 37 and 38 of the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act. That Act was designed with a future resilience in mind to provide powers to add new codes of practice or guidance. But I look forward to hearing the rest of the debate and working closely with Christine Graham and the committee members as this bill progresses. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. I now call Maurice Golden. Around 5 minutes, Mr Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Let me first begin by congratulating Christine Graham for introducing this bill and indeed her concerted efforts over My time in Parliament on attempting to improve animal welfare more generally. The policy memorandum states that the aim of this bill is to improve the health and well-being of dogs throughout their lives by establishing a more responsible and informed approach to acquiring and owning a dog. Ideally, a prospective owner would take time to fully consider the implications of getting a dog, but Blue Cross point out that a significant minority of prospective owners don't do the research they should. According to the Scottish SPCA, dog ownership has increased since 2020, but so too have low welfare puppy dealers chasing profit. Research from the University of Edinburgh shows that, sadly, those dogs often suffer from behavioural issues and illnesses as a result of the breeding conditions. Current efforts to tackle this mostly focus on the supply of dogs, such as the ongoing efforts of the Scottish SPCA to disrupt the estimated £13 million a year puppy farming trade, for which we all commend them. But it's the demand for dogs that gives the unscrupulous breeders an opportunity to exploit. So we must ensure that demand is more informed and responsible. But the PDSA's 2023 Animal Wellbeing Report shows low levels of awareness of best practice across the UK. For example, less than half of dog owners knew puppies for sale should be seen with their mother. Part one of the bill would help address these knowledge gaps through a new code of practice and accompanying certificates. This would include questions for prospective buyers, such as whether the breed is suitable for their family, if they can afford to look after the dog, etc. But Blue Cross and the Scottish Government have pointed to the opportunity to include information on breed-specific health issues as well. These could also be useful measures, but I note the Rural Affairs Committee has recommended the questions do not appear on the face of the bill. Chiming, happy to.
Christine Graham.
I have to say I would resist being more breed specific, because you then start to clutter rather simple questions about considering the breed. And if you're considering the breed, you're obviously looking at what it requires and if it's got any particular problems in breeding and so on. So I think if we start to put too much in, I wanted to keep it simple and direct.
Maurice Golden.
I think that makes a lot of sense, and it could actually be a type specific as well, which you then very quickly start going down a number of rabbit holes on that one, as we have seen with other dog-related legislation. Now, whilst to comply with the code wouldn't be an offence in itself, we should remember the intent of the bill is to educate and encourage, not punish, in which case it's perhaps better thought of as a means to encourage people to pause and think when acquiring a dog. There has also been disagreement on whether the code should be a new standalone code or as an update to the 2010 Code of Practice on Dog Ownership. And I think the Scottish SPCA make a good argument for having a combined code, pointing out it would be easier to prove in an investigation that someone should have knowledge of a single source of information versus multiple sources. Part two of the bill, which the Scottish Government is seeking to remove at stage two, would allow prohibiting the first owner of a litter to sell or transfer them within 12 months of birth without registering them on a database. And this would cover litters falling outside current regulations. Inevitably, this focuses on low-volume breeders, such as family pets having puppies. In contrast, the Kennel Club point out that the focus should be on properly enforcing the existing regulations aimed at high-volume breeders. I also note the Minister's comments regarding registration does not come with the same welfare responsibilities as licensing, potentially creating a false sense of assurance for potential buyers. I would be supportive of a centralised database of puppies being sold, or indeed improved interoperability between the existing databases. And I know that Christine Graham and the Minister have spoken about the potential for microchipping to aid greater traceability. In closing, let me be clear that the Scottish Conservatives agree with the principle behind this bill. We want to see healthy, happy dogs as a result of more responsible ownership, and we'll be voting for the bill at stage one.
Thank you, Mr Golden. I now call Rhoda Grant. Around 5 minutes, Ms Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too want to put on record Christine Graham's work on the illegal, the welfare of dogs, and indeed her work on the illegal puppy trade. She's done a lot of work in the Parliament on this issue, and I pay tribute to that work. And it's very difficult to disagree with the general principles of this bill, because it's about improving animal welfare, it's about ensuring responsible ownership of pets. The rise in ownership of dogs during COVID is something we've all seen. People were at home, they were able to look after their pets, and those who didn't give it sufficient thought are now struggling to keep those pets well looked after when they're returning to the office. And we hear of rehousing charities talking about the number of abandoned dogs that they have. We've also heard about the growth in illegal puppy farms to meet that demand for puppies. And that's something that we really need to challenge. But this is a member's bill, so it's naturally restricted in what it can do. And therefore, I believe that there is scope within the bill, if the government were to take up the challenge, to go further in dealing with illegal puppy farms than the bill does at the moment. And I'm clear that the bill can't do that. A member's bill is very restricted. So it might be good if the Scottish government would look at how they amend it. We've heard about part two of the bill, where the Scottish government has more difficulty with, and indeed difficulties lie. But again, I think this part of the bill is really important, if we could get it right, because it provides for a register of unlicensed litters, and people who are not breeders can allow their pets to have puppies, and currently there are no protections for those puppies. Breeders obviously have to be licensed and follow standards. And the ability of people just to have dogs bred without being licensed breeders actually creates a loophole for the illegal breeders who hide under that radar. And they are able to do that. We've heard of them using holiday rentals to portray as their own homes, where they take the puppies. And quite often they will take a dog with them that is maybe not the mother of that litter of puppies. And they don't care anything about animal welfare. And we often hear of people saying that they bought a puppy and then discovered that they had huge vet bills and that puppy was unwell and maybe didn't survive after paying a lot of money for it. So I totally understand why Christine Graham seeks to have all litters registered to try and close this loophole. But I also understand that that could be challenging, because we were told by Battersea Dog and Cats Home that although microchipping of dogs is now a legal requirement, only about 20% of the dogs they take in are chipped. And therefore, there's an issue with enforcement at present, far less if we look at a new register. There's also concerns about whether the details of that register could be publicly accessible, so that people could look at it to see whether or not their puppy was actually registered because of GDPR. Therefore, yes, of course it will.
Christine Graham.
I will go into more detail in that as summing up, but the UK has come quite a distance in this, and what they're suggesting, if they have a portal for all these individual microchipping companies so that somebody can access it, it's only for the police and animal welfare agencies, it's not for general public consumption.
Rhoda Grant, I can give you the time back for the intervention.
And I'm grateful of that intervention, because I think there is the ability of all those different companies, and there are a lot of different companies that deal in microchip registers, to come together and that to be available for scrutiny. And maybe even people could check with a vet whether a pet had indeed been microchipped. I'm conscious... Yes.
Edward Mountain.
I thank the member for giving way. I think there's five companies that provide microchips across the United Kingdom. The problem isn't so much of collating that information. The problem is the fact that people don't keep the data up to speed on those microchips. So when people change dogs, they don't register that. So the whole thing is fraught with problems. And I understand that vets also are concerned about being the ones to police microchips. So does the member think that this might need more thought, which is why part two of the bill might need to be considered again?
Rhoda Grant, and again, I give you the time back.
Yes, indeed, it does need more thought. And that's not a criticism of Christine Graham, because there is a limit to what a member of this Parliament as a backbencher can bring forward and the complexity of that legislation. But government have an opportunity during stage two of this bill to look at what they can do to work with the organisations that Christine Graham spoke about to make this workable, because I think this single issue would go a long way of actually bringing the illegal traders to book. So therefore, I believe that the general principles of this bill should be supported. I would urge the government to look at the bill to make sure that we can improve it as it goes through the Parliament process and hopefully bring an end to the scourge of illegal puppy farming.
Thank you, Ms Grant. I now call Ariane Burgess. Around 4 minutes, Ms Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was horrified to find out about a case of illegal cruel puppy farming in my region in Inverness earlier this year. A couple had rented out their cottage for 3 days. Imagine their shock and horror when they returned to find 14 neglected puppies caked in faeces and urine, with some within a cage, and then to find out that those puppies were being sold for £1,500 to unsuspecting buyers. While appalling, and unfortunately this is not a very rare story, the puppy trade is a multi-million pound industry. The illegal underside of the trade has strong links to serious organised crime groups that operate throughout the UK. This quote from the Scottish Society for Prevention to Cruelty to Animals, evidenced at Westminster, does not pull any punches. Bred purely for profit, puppies from puppy farms are often kept in conditions reminiscent of intensive farming systems. Bitches are bred too often. Many are unhealthy and live in unbearably poor conditions. Puppies are generally removed from their mothers far too early and are then transported in unsuitable conditions to satisfy public demand. Unfortunately, low welfare breeding is on the rise despite the best efforts of the SSPCA and others to tackle it. They are even seeing a boom in unregulated, unsafe canine fertility clinics to help meet the public's demand for dogs. While criminal activity is rising to exploit public demand, we can guard against it by supporting public awareness, education and responsibility around dog ownership. And that is exactly what this bill aims to do. And I want to extend wholeheartedly congratulations to Christine Graham for being such a strong, consistent advocate for companion animal welfare and for bringing this bill to fruition with great hard work and focus. The Scottish Greens have always been fully committed to animal welfare, from protecting mountain hares from slaughter on grass moors to ending live sports on farm animals with the UK. From banning the use of cruel snare traps to securing new powers for the SSPCA to investigate wildlife crime, the Scottish Greens were integral in securing those protections for our fellow creatures. And my Green colleague Mark Ruskell is working tirelessly to end the cruel practice of greyhound racing. So it's no surprise that we are supportive of this bill. Of course, the Scottish Greens support the intention to protect animal welfare by establishing a more responsible approach to dog ownership and enhanced monitoring and traceability in the breeding and sale of puppies. We support the intention of the code. And on the monitoring and traceability, I do recognise the Scottish Government's concerns that raised about the design of Part 2 and the register, and it is good to hear today from Christine Graham that she is content to see a microchipping scheme for traceability, and the Scottish Greens will do our part to ensure that it is a priority of the Scottish Government's. I know that there is support from across the chamber for improving companion animal welfare. Maurice Goldman has done great work to build support for a ban on electric shock collars. Scottish Labour want to ban the import of very young puppies, and the Liberal Democrats supported the Fireworks and Pyrotechnic Bill partly protects pets from distress. Members may have different ideas about how the most effective solutions or the best way to achieve these intentions, given limited resource. But given the non-controversial nature of the aims, this bill presents an opportunity for MSPs from across the chamber to work collaboratively together, design the most effective legislation, and to really get this right. The Scottish Greens will support the general principles of this bill and encourage our other parties to do the same. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Burgess. A reminder that members who are participating in the debate need to be in for both the opening and the closing speeches. We are now moving to the open debate, and I call first Claire Hawkey to be followed by Jamie Hawker-Johnston. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Hawkey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to begin by thanking Christine Graham for her work on this bill so far on issues that I know are very close to her heart, and of course to thank the committee for their work on the Stage 1 report. There's been a huge shift in attitudes that we hold as a nation about the welfare and care of animals over the years, which of course is very welcome. And recently the 6th annual Holyrood Dog of the Year competition took place, described by the Edinburgh Reporter as arguably the most sought after accolade in Scottish politics. A subjective matter, of course, and I'll continue my one woman campaign for the Holyrood Cat of the Year. But nonetheless, I am sure colleagues would join me in congratulating my colleague Marie McNair and Heidi on winning this year's coveted title. This competition is not only about celebrating the positive impact that dog ownership has on people's lives, but plays an important role in spotlighting welfare issues and keeps a focus on where improvements could be made. Presiding Officer, there's been a surge in dog ownership across Scotland, in part no doubt exacerbated by COVID. And sadly, this growth has come hand in hand with reports of record numbers of pets being surrendered to animal rescue centres across the country. Where there's a surge in demand, there is a scrabble to provide supply, leading unfortunately to a rise in unscrupulous breeding. And the committee report acknowledges evidence from stakeholders that the effects of irresponsible breeding can be catastrophic, from young puppies dying within hours of going home to their new families, to puppies and their mothers facing serious health risks. And this bill shines a light not only on the need for us to continue to strive for the highest animal welfare standards possible, to call out and stamp out cruel and irresponsible breeding practices, which care more about money than a love of dogs, but also to continue to open what might be a difficult conversation. There's no doubt that for as much joy and companionship a dog can bring to its owner's life, it also brings a great deal of responsibility and duty. Welcoming a dog into your home should be a big decision. And it's very concerning to hear stakeholders' concerns that people can be unsure what questions to ask, what research to do before taking this step. The Kennel Club state that at least a fifth of people will spend less than 2 hours researching whether or not to buy a puppy, potentially a 15-year commitment, with a third of them telling them they don't know how to spot a rogue breeder. Ultimately, people need trusted information about the important questions to ask of breeders, health concerns related to particular breeds, and their responsibilities as owners. Members across the chamber will know that for many years I've called for an end to the cruel and outdated practice of greyhound racing. And earlier this year, I was pleased to welcome Mark Ruskell's bill on its prohibition. I want to pay tribute to the many organisations and individuals who have campaigned for years for an end to greyhound racing, many of them my own constituents, and that they've highlighted the welfare concerns of those dogs to the public and to elected members right across the political spectrum. In my Rutherglen constituency, that chapter of history is now closing, and our community can look forward to a new future for the Shawfield Stadium site. What became very clear to me from the constituents who contacted me ahead of this debate was how deeply important animal welfare issues are to them. Like many, perhaps all across chamber, I would definitely characterise my constituency as one of dog lovers. In closing, Presiding Officer, the crux of the bill is to improve the health and well-being of dogs throughout their lives, starting from the very point that a prospective owner decides to welcome one into their life. This is a name I'm sure we can all support, and I look forward to the further discussions on how it can be progressed.
Thank you, Ms Hockey. I now call Jamie Hockle-Johnson to be followed by Karen Adam. Mr Hockle-Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I add my congratulations to that of others, to Christine Graham on bringing forward this bill, and also for resisting the temptation to burst into song during her speech. I think that was very well received. I doubt anyone in this chamber would disagree with the aims of the bill to improve the health and well-being of dogs throughout their lives, nor the need to encourage the public to have a more responsible and informed approach when choosing where, from where, and if to get a dog. Unfortunately, in too many cases, it is a failure of some members of the public to do the necessary checks that allow the worst cases and the worst perpetrators to continue to operate. They allow unscrupulous, cruel criminals to be involved in activities like puppy farming and to make so much money, estimated, as others have said, at about £13 million in Scotland alone, from the misery and suffering of dogs, that is, the illegal trade in animals. And I hate to use the term puppy farming, because it couldn't be any further from the idea of farming that I know. Yes, we all have to make a living within the agriculture sector, but the care and welfare of our animals is an important part of any farmer's life and responsibilities. And for these places to be described as puppy farms is actually quite jarring. Yeah. When our dog Toby, our last dog sadly now long past, was first born, he was the runt of the litter. So I'm already upsetting my colleagues here with this heartrending story. He was very small and weak, and we spent the first few days of his life uncertain over whether he would live. He took a lot of nurturing to survive, but he turned out to be a big and boisterous and brilliant dog, very much the definition of a good boy. But it took time, and I mention this because I can't imagine the situation that he would have faced if he'd been born in one of these illegal puppy farms. He would have been expendable, a lost asset, at best worth nothing more than his sale value. And, of course, he was lucky that he ended up with us, a family with generational experience of looking after dogs, and who would ensure that any illness or injuries were dealt with straight away, no matter the cost. He was, unfortunately, a sufferer of Addison's disease, which meant a lifetime of expensive drugs, but these were provided without hesitation. That is not the fate of all dogs, not all have responsible or even caring owners. And I'm sure that the Edinburgh University research, Maurice Golden, highlighted that low welfare production often leads to serious behavioural issues and illnesses, would be supported by the experience of one of my family members who works in the canine behavioural sector. Dogs which already have issues find themselves with families really not able to provide the care those dogs so desperately need. Presiding Officer, as others have highlighted in stark numbers, the illegal puppy trade has grown exponentially in the last few years. A new code of practice for the buying, selling and giving away of puppies as pets could help address this. The Scottish Conservatives... yes, of course.
Emma Harper.
Thank you. Thanks very much for taking an intervention. As recently as February this year, 24 Cockapoo and Cavapoo puppies were discovered in dire situation, confined under a lorry in cardboard boxes coming off the ferry at Cairn Ryan. So do you think that there are aspects in this, in the general principles of this bill that would help address this puppy trafficking that we are still seeing in Cairn Ryan?
Through the chair, please. Jamie Hockle-Johnson.
Thank you very much. I thank the member for the intervention. And yes, I do. And I'm just kind of coming on to our general support. I mean, I think we welcome the undoubtedly action against any undoubtedly illegal activities. And we know that this is, we're only seeing the cases that are found, not those that unfortunately are getting through. Just to summarise, the Scottish Conservatives support this bill's attempts to improve the health and well-being of dogs by encouraging responsible ownership. And we will support this bill at stage one. But we would agree with the Scottish Government that part two of the bill should be removed at stage two, as we don't believe creating a register for litters from unlicensed breeders would enhance dog welfare. With regards to Christine Graham's alternative approach, I recognise the Minister's strong support for this approach, and we do remain open-minded about the centralised microchip database for puppies being sold. But as the committee indicated in their report, we would want the views of the UK Government and other stakeholders, of course, to be consulted. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the British are often described as a nation of dog lovers, but too many dogs are being mistreated for profit. Too many are born and die in misery. We can all agree that is unacceptable. So I welcome all efforts that will combat this abuse and which can help improve the lives of man's and woman's best friend. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Hockle-Johnson. I now call Karen Adam to be followed by Colin Smith. Ms Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a joy to speak in this debate today, and I want to thank Christine Graham for her tireless efforts in providing much support for the welfare of animals across Scotland. I have many cherished memories of my dogs, and they have been an integral part of my life. Each wagging tail and each slobbery kiss and each loving gaze has filled my heart with so much happiness. They were my childhood comforters, certainly my teenage confidants, and my loyal, trusted companions throughout all life's ups and downs. But, Presiding Officer, amidst this joy, I am acutely aware of the responsibilities that come with dog ownership. The decision to bring a dog into one's life is not one to be taken lightly, and it requires careful consideration, thoughtful planning, and a deep understanding of the commitment involved. I have made mistakes in the past. I have rushed decisions, and I now regret them. But these experiences have taught me invaluable lessons. My journey finding the dog that I have now, my Great Dane Matilda, was not a swift one. It involved months of research, deliberation, and searching for the right breeder and the right dog. The process was meticulous, but it was necessary to ensure that Matilda would not only be a suitable companion, but also a healthy and a happy one. I certainly support the essence of Christine Graham's Member's Bill, as it seeks to improve the health and welfare of dogs by fostering a more responsible and informed approach to dog ownership. The Scottish SPCA, in their efforts to protect animals from cruelty and neglect, has borne witness to the grim realities of this trade. They have seen firsthand the consequences of impulse purchasing and irresponsible breeding practices, where puppies are deprived of necessities such as human contact, socialisation and proper veterinary care, often facing a lifetime of health issues and behavioural problems because of their traumatic beginnings. My search for Matilda was a privilege that I could afford. The online searches, the cost of her breed, the travel of hundreds of miles to get her, and the overnight stay. And I recognise that this is a route that may not be accessible to all, and it certainly wasn't available to me in the past. And this was not how my other dogs came into my life. So as we navigate this bill, we must ensure that we do strike a balance. We must safeguard the welfare of dogs without creating unnecessary barriers for those on reduced incomes who still deserve the joy and companionship that a dog can bring to a family. I support the proposal for the Scottish Government to develop and publish a code of practice that outlines the responsibilities of both potential dog owners and those involved in selling or giving away dogs. This code will encourage individuals to carefully assess their suitability for dog ownership and consider whether they can provide for all of that dog's needs throughout its life. It is a reminder that dog ownership is not a decision to be made lightly, but a lifelong commitment that requires dedication, resources, and unwavering love. In addition to safeguarding the welfare of dogs, this bill also aims to educate the public about the risks associated with buying from unscrupulous dealers and the importance of responsible ownership. By raising awareness and providing additional oversight, we can empower individuals to make informed decisions, deter low welfare dealers, and hold irresponsible breeders accountable for their actions. Through awareness campaigns, educational initiatives and community outreach programmes, we could support individuals to make ethical choices, support responsible breeders and reject the exploitative practices of puppy farms and low welfare dealers. I often remember that a puppy is not just for Christmas, and I'm glad to see that we still have that in mind oftentimes every year. This can work, I think, in educating the public if we get the PR campaigns correct. In closing, Presiding Officer, let us remember that behind every statistic, there are countless tails wagging with unconditional love and loyalty, and let us honour their trust by standing united in our commitment to the welfare of dogs and in our resolve to create a future where every dog is treated with the care, respect and the compassion that they deserve. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Adam. I now call Colin Smith to be followed by Emma Harper. Mrs Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and my apologies for missing the very opening couple of paragraphs of Christine Graham's opening comments. The impulse to buy a dog is understandable. They bring joy and comfort to people's lives. They become treasured companions, members of the family. But looking after a dog is also a huge commitment. It can be a 15-year commitment, something which some prospective buyers don't always appreciate. They require daily walks, activity, interaction. We all see that our pets are happiest when they're out and about. All this has to be factored into the working week and family life. On top of this is the expense of caring for a dog, including veterinary costs, which can be steep, not least at a time families are facing a cost of living crisis. Many of us will know someone who purchased a puppy during the pandemic who admit they didn't anticipate the time and effort required to keep their pet happy and healthy. Of course, most people rise to the challenge, but a significant minority don't, particularly if the young dog has come through unscrupulous breeders. These dogs often have serious behavioural issues and experience serious ill health later in life. Some owners simply don't have the understanding or the experience to care for them. As a result, many are abandoned or taken to shelters to be rehomed. And I know from my visits to the SSPCA Rescue and Rehoming Centre in Hamilton and Dumfries and Galloway Canine Rescue that these centres are bursting at the seams. Therefore, I very much welcome the general principles of Christine Graham's bill. We need to prevent the impulse purchasing of puppies and young dogs and tackle demand, a point many members have highlighted. Where there is demand, there is also a trade where rogue dealers seek profit at the expense of animal welfare. Just a couple of months ago, in my own region at the Port of Cairn Ryan, a large group of puppies were found in an appalling condition, confined under a lorry and cardboard boxes without any food or any water. The poor pups were suffering from severe ear mites and other health issues. Thankfully, due to the efforts of the SSPCA, they all survived and have all since been rehomed. But unless we tackle demand, these tragic scenes will be repeated time and time again. Education is key. The proposed code of practice and certificate providing documentary proof that both buyer and seller have complied could help. This should encourage people to pause and reflect before deciding whether a dog is right for them. It could also aid in spotting irresponsible puppy dealers. There have been some discussion on exactly what should be in that code. Blue Cross makes several suggestions in its briefing to MSPs which require serious consideration. They recommend a question on whether the prospective owner is aware of the specific legal duties required of an owner. This could be of relevance in future welfare cases. Another question on the awareness of the significant health and welfare problems faced by individual breeders is also recommended. This includes flat-nosed breeds like French Bulldogs. These breeds suffer from a range of health issues, most notably breathing difficulties. A high percentage cannot live a happy and healthy quality of life without veterinary intervention. But whatever Parliament eventually agrees should be in the code, it is essential that it's standalone, concise and an accessible code of practice. We must avoid the potential for confusion or overlap with the 2010 code. The issue of enforcing the new code has also been raised. Currently, there are no proposals for any enforcement mechanisms or consequences for breach of the code itself. Some animal welfare charities say this could present challenges in ensuring compliance. The Dogs Trust anticipate that responsible breeders will ask prospective owners for the proposed certificate. However, they highlight there is little to disincentivise more unscrupulous breeders and sellers from ignoring the need for such a certificate. So Blue Cross, I think, are right in recommending that should there be significant non-compliance once the bill is law, the Scottish Government should consider fixed penalty notices for non-compliance, with the code becoming a legal requirement. Yeah, I certainly will, yeah.
Christine Graham.
I think the member, I hope he will accept that it's very difficult in a member's bill to get into these complexities. But reference is made in my bill to existing animal welfare legislation, which will come into force if there's issues of cruelty. And the lack or the evidence of a certificate will be part of that in ensuring, if necessary, a prosecution.
Colin Smith.
I thank Christine Graham for a very helpful intervention, and I fully accept the complexity of bringing forward some of these proposals in a member's bill itself. But the certificate, I do think, will play a role, and I hope, making unscrupulous breeders more traceable by enforcement agencies. We must ensure that any registration system is user-friendly, easily accessible, centralised and transparent. So I support the idea of a register of unlicensed litters of puppies. Under such a change, animal welfare charities say it would not be possible for puppies to be sold in Scotland by someone who is not regulated in some way. Otherwise, the bill could lose much of its potential impact, a point emphasised by Blue Cross, without such a register. The Law Society's detailed briefing to members also raises several issues which should be given proper consideration at stage two. For example, they argue it should be the supplier rather than prospective buyer who should have to confirm they have checked that the dog is at least 8 weeks of age, particularly as they are also required to sign the certificate. Finally, the Kennel Club, who agree that there should be a more responsible and informed approach to owning the dog, also highlight that the current regulations are not adequately enforced. Therefore, they say, and I quote, whether you're a bad breeder, a rogue breeder, or importing the legally bred dogs, you can pretty much get away with it. So we have to ask ourselves, why is this the case, and what can we do to improve enforcement of the current regulations? If it's about resources, then we should ensure these are made available. We must tackle supply as well as demand. In concluding, Presiding Officer, there are still some issues to be ironed out in Christine Graham's bill, but the central aim is one that I very much welcome and fully support. I have the privilege of being Christine Graham's deputy on the cross-party group on animal welfare, and I know how passionate she is about this issue. So I pay tribute to her long-standing commitment to animal welfare, and this bill is another example of that. We must and we can do more to end the scourge of rogue breeders and ensure that more dogs live a happy and healthy life. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Edward Mountain. Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm happy to speak in support of the general principles at stage one of Christine Graham's Welfare of Dogs Bill. I have long advocated for a variety of policies to support and advance animal welfare, including taking forward my own member's bill for livestock worrying legislation in 2021. And responsible acquisition or giving away or selling a dog is what we need to aim for. The Minister mentioned personality and behaviours of dogs in his opening, and the Tway Border Collies Maya, who won the first Holyrood Dog of the Year, and she's now 12 years old, and Meg, she's 13. These are the Tway dogs that we have in our house, and they're both collies, and you know, it requires a lot to keep their brains active and give them lots of exercise, and both of them are rescue dogs. So I think talking about the way we acquire dogs and the types of personalities is absolutely important when we think about how people are going to acquire a dog. I also want to put on record my thanks and recognition to Christine Graham for her work in bringing forward her Member's Bill to the Chamber. I know the amount of work which goes into a Member's Bill, so kudos to Christine Graham and her team for putting in this hard graft. Presiding Officer, as many members will be aware, I have campaigned for stronger action to address the horrific illegal puppy trafficking trade, and others have mentioned illegal puppy trafficking in the Chamber this afternoon. But in the time I have this afternoon, I will focus much of my comments on this. There has been a real increase in the practice of selling puppies without considering the puppy's welfare. This is a particular issue in the South Scotland region, and Colin Smith has just highlighted that as well. The SSPCA report that illegal puppies are still being brought into Scotland through the port of Cairnryan, and then they're sold in areas in Scotland and the wider UK. Illegally bred puppies sold through a black market trade on social media or small advert sites have been identified as a significant source of revenue for serious organised crime gangs. Price tags for some designer breeds can reach thousands of pounds. Prosecutors at the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service are concerned that money raised by unauthorised puppy dealers from some online platforms could be laundered to support drug traffickers and other criminal activity as part of a multi-million pound enterprise. A Scottish multi-agency strategic threat assessment, right, SMASTA report, published last year, reported that the market for illegally traded puppies is estimated at £13 million. And so far this year, the Scottish SPCA have received 336 calls in connection with puppy farms and puppy breeding. Many of the pups involved later suffer severe health problems and either cost their new owners huge vets bills or are too ill to survive their first months. This demonstrates that puppy trafficking is indeed a hugely pressing issue, and it's one that this bill and the proposed code can seek to address. And as the committee's stage one report highlights, and to quote directly from Christine Graham, 6 years ago, I became aware of the growth of supply of puppies and dogs purchased online and from puppy factory farms, and so Ms Graham goes on to say, I decided that if supply was not the issue, the current legislation and policing were not having a sufficient impact and that I should perhaps tackle demand, which would have an effect on supply. Ms Graham said that her bill would be a valuable tool alongside other ongoing work set out by the Scottish Government in the Minister's evidence. Indeed, according to the evidence taken at committee, this view is also supported by the Scottish SPCA and indeed the Scottish Government. The Scottish Government had a Buy a Puppy Safely campaign with a budget of £300,000 and £225,000 of that was for media to be paid for and overall development of the campaign, and then the remaining £75,000 was to cover insight and evaluation. The campaign aimed to help people source their new puppy responsibly by informing them of the consequences of illegal puppy farming, arming them with knowledge of the warning signs to look out for and directing them to Buy a Puppy Safely website. While these steps are of course welcome, as the SSPCA said, more targeted action is needed to combat this illicit trade, and I believe this bill will be an additional tool to do that. So, Presiding Officer, in closing, the Scottish Government has set out its support for the general principles of the bill, but has also outlined areas where it has felt that the bill could usefully be amended. So I do believe this bill has huge value in improving the welfare of dogs, and I welcome Christine Graham's commitment to working with the Scottish Government on this. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Harper. I now call Edward Mountain to be followed by Alistair Allen. Mr Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And before I go any further, I'm going to declare an interest that's not on my register of interest. Sitting at home, I've got 7 four-week-old Labrador puppies, which will be clamouring, no doubt, to be fed, not to see me. But we take puppies, and I think those who have ownership of dogs, very seriously. And before I would go any further, I'm not going to be as ungallant to suggest that I don't remember the song that Christine Graham mentioned at the beginning about the puppy dog in the window. I do clearly remember that song. And I'm very glad that we've moved on from those days when puppy dogs were in the windows of pet shops and were for sale and sparked people going in there just to buy them on impulse. Now, what's not to like about this bill? You know, it talks about improving the health and well-being of dogs. Well, we all want to do that. And we need to remember that when we're doing this and when we're talking about this bill, that there are 2/3 of the households across the United Kingdom that have pets in them. It's a really big undertaking. I don't believe it's a right. I think it's something that you have to take on seriously and consider about it before you do it. For example, you know, if you're going to talk about puppies, you know, the price varies. It can be as low as £1,000, it can go up to £2,500 to £3,000. It's a huge investment for a properly bred puppy from somebody who's looked after it properly. Then you've got every time you go down and buy a sack of food, it's about £34 for 15 kilos of food. It's a big expense. And it's a big expense if you take them to the vet. You know, vets don't cost 50p, and rightly so, because they give excellent care to your dogs. Last year, I was in the situation where I took one of my dogs to the vet school in Edinburgh, and I have to say, unfortunately, the treatment it got wasn't sufficient to save it, but it was hugely expensive. And there comes that choice when you're looking after a pet. You have to understand the whole life cost of taking on the pet. So that there's parts of this bill that I do agree with. I'm happy with part one of the bill. I think the code of practice the questions that are in there are really good questions and ones that we should be asking ourselves. And I like the fact that you can't sell puppies below 8 weeks. Why would you want to? It's not in the puppy's interest. It's not in the mother's interest either. And I also think it's good news that you see the mother before you buy the puppies. It gives you a really good indication of the health of the puppies that you're buying from. And it gives you an indication of the way that mother is being looked after, which to me gives you an indication on whether you're getting a decent puppy. My problem slightly, though, on this section is the fact about the certificate that you have to sign and the fact that you have to keep that for the entire duration of the puppy's life. Now, hopefully, if you get a good run of things, you know, you can have a dog for 14 years. I'm not sure I can find all the paperwork for my eldest dog, who's 10 years old at the moment. It's somewhere in a desk somewhere, but I'm a little bit concerned that that's going to be something that might be difficult. And I also slightly worried about the enforcement of should you not be able to produce that certificate. It's probably not through lack of trying, and some people may be caught out. I will, of course, give way to the member.
Christine Graham.
Can the member locate his marriage certificate and the children's birth certificates? Just pop it beside them.
Edward Benson.
Do you know, I can answer that is no, I can't, but my wife can, and she reminds me of where my marriage certificate is at all times. But I do like part one of the bill. I just think I'd like to see a bit more scrutiny at stage two. Now, I'm conscious of time, and I just want to make this this comment on the issue of microchipping. I absolutely believe it's important to microchip a dog. And, you know, you do that at 8 weeks when you've got puppies, you take it up to the vet. That's probably the first time that the slightly larger needle is suitable to be put into the dog. But if that database is not kept up to speed, if you don't change that database and you register the new owners, and the new owner, if it changes hands, keeps that up to speed, it could be a problem. And what we certainly heard, and I was privileged to be part of the British Veterinary Association dinner, what vets don't want to be having to do is to police that database and make sure that the dog that they think they're treating has got the right microchip in it. What they're conscious of wanting to do is to treat the dog and give the dog the best treatment possible, not worry about it at the stage when it's presented. So we have no way of policing it. So I'm happy with this bill. At the first part, I'm less happy about the part two of the bill, but I'm very happy to be able to support it going through the chamber this evening, and look forward to be given the opportunity at stage two to raise some amendments on the areas of concern. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. And I now call Alistair Allen, who will be the last speaker before we move to closing speeches. Dr. Allen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm not going to try and do a vote of thanks for what was a very well-informed debate today, but may I thank Christine Graham for what I understand are the 6 years of work that lie behind her bill. And indeed, I'd like to thank her for the evidence which she has already provided us with on the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee. I know that the welfare of animals is a subject very close to Ms. Graham's heart, and she should be commended for her consistent advocacy on this subject in this place. Presiding Officer, our history as a nation of dog lovers has been alluded to and has played a key role in Scotland's folklore. Greyfriars Bobby's grave is visited by countless visitors every year, and even before that, Mary Queen of Scots was well known for her love of dogs, having acquired this affection during her time in France. Upon Mary Queen of Scots' execution, it is incidentally believed that her loyal canine, Folly, a terrier, was found hiding at her feet. A lot continue much further in that vein, Presiding Officer, you'll be pleased to know. I'm prompted to mention it all merely by the sudden recollection of Christine Graham's campaign some years ago to repatriate to Scotland the respective components of Mary Queen of Scots. In any case, Presiding Officer, in the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee, there was a widespread acceptance that the aims of this proposed legislation are good. There is always more that we can do to ensure the legality, safety and robustness of the way in which dog breeding and dog sales are governed. Therefore, I believe on the whole that we should support the general principles of this bill at stage one. The bill proposes a new code of practice regarding acquiring and supplying a dog. And while powers do already exist to introduce codes of practice relating to animal welfare under sections 37 and 38 of the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act 2006, the proposed code is structured around the duty of care, which will be placed on the owner to meet welfare needs, which are based on the internationally recognised Five Freedoms approach. Now, as the MSP for the Western Isles, where the use of working dogs is still important, I believe that we should consider whether the scope of Part 1 of this bill should also extend to all dogs, regardless of the purposes for which they are kept. And indeed, the Scottish Government's current code of practice for the welfare of dogs applies to all dogs, whether they be pets or working animals. After hearing evidence from both stakeholders and reading written responses at the Rural Affairs Committee, I believe this is worth considering. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, whilst there are some proposals within this bill which will not entirely have convinced some members of the committee that they are necessary to improve animal welfare, I am confident that there is scope for useful and helpful amendments from members across the chamber to ensure that this bill does what it seeks to do, which is to ensure the long-term welfare of Scotland's dogs. Often, as others have pointed out today, in the face of great cruelty and very often in the face of organised crime. And on that basis, Presiding Officer, I'm very happy to support Ms Graham's bill at stage one and to endorse its general principles.
Thank you, Dr Allen. And we will now move to closing speeches. And I call on Arianne Burgess to close on behalf of the Scottish Greens. Ms Burgess.
Thank you. As we've heard today, having a dog as a pet can bring such joy, comfort and other benefits. And that's why the Scottish Greens have been working to secure rights for tenants to keep pets. But prospective pet owners do need to be aware of the risks. Recently, a neighbour of mine was bitten by a dog while out running. The owners were right there, but couldn't control their dogs. This contrasted sharply with another recent encounter when a dog appeared on a path where I was running. The dog could have reacted aggressively, but it stood there, looked at me, and then looked back at its owner, who was walking along another path. So much comes down to training. It's a real skill to properly train and control a dog and to do this while centering animal welfare. Puppies born in a low welfare environment can develop behavioural issues which pose a risk to humans, to other dogs, and especially to livestock during lambing season. So there are two issues here: improving awareness of the responsibility and skill involved in training, handling, and caring for dogs, and deterring illegal breeding and selling of dogs to give them the best possible start in life. On the latter point, ideally we would work with counterparts across the UK to address cross-border issues like the unvaccinated pups from intensive puppy rearing systems that are imported into Cairn Ryan ferry ports in the appalling conditions, as we've heard today, to be sold in Scotland. This bill puts animal welfare front and centre. And I know Christine Graham cares deeply about this, and I will continue to work tirelessly with her and constructively to ensure that the legislation is effective. In that pursuit, I'll highlight some key asks from animal welfare organisations. Alongside the code of practice, there needs to be a public education campaign to help bring about the necessary human behaviour change and prevent the impulse purchasing of dogs. There is a need for clarity around how the certificate will be enforced. In general, there is a need for improved resource for enforcing this new legislation, as well as existing legislation around the sale, trade, health and welfare of pets. And that must include resource for local authorities who could use it to improve data sharing on these issues. And finally, monitoring and tackling the online trade in dogs will be critical. And it is good to hear that there's a potential way forward through microchipping. Presiding Officer, this bill admirably shines a light on issues that must be addressed to uphold animal welfare. I would encourage members to extend this concern to other animals as well. Our farm animals are routinely subject to painful operations without anaesthetic, something that most people wouldn't dream of accepting for their pets. Just as this bill aims to promote public awareness of how human behaviour impacts on canine welfare, I'd like to promote better awareness of how human activity impacts the welfare of all other sentient beings on our farms, in our seas, and throughout our natural world. This bill is a great place to start, and I fully support the general principles of the bill.
Thank you, Ms Burgess. I now call on Rhoda Grant to close on behalf of Scottish Labour. Ms Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This has been a good debate, and I think there has been much consensus around the need for further education on purchasing dogs, and that was a point made by Christine Graham and indeed amplified by many other speakers, indeed all speakers, this afternoon. Education to encourage people to think, to make sure that people know how to identify a rogue breeder, and to make sure that people know what is required from a breed and if it is suitable for their own home. Colin Smith talked about impulse purchasing, and having people stop and have that pause will stop impulse purchasing. A number of speakers, including Colin, talked about puppies being found at Cairn Ryan, being smuggled into the country. And I wonder if perhaps the Scottish Government might speak to Irish counterparts if Cairn Ryan appears to be a place where illegal puppies are being smuggled into the country, to try and put a stop to this. Colin Smith also talked about the certificate that was required under the bill to be signed by both sellers and buyers, and both having to answer a number of questions outlined in the bill to make sure before they could get that certificate. And the certificate itself wasn't a cause for concern because it would give pause. But there was concerns about the questions on the certificate being in the face of the bill. Now, people were very clear that those questions were necessary, and indeed a number of people talked about having more questions. Again, Colin Smith and Maurice Golden talked about breed-specific questions about breed health and what to look out for, what should be discouraged during the purchase of a dog, such as the flat-nosed breeds that had difficulty in breathing. So the suggestion would be, and I'm minded to be supportive of this, that those questions be set in regulation in order that they could be updated and modified as necessary. And that might be something that Christine Graham might consider as we go through to stage two of the bill. A number of members talked about the code of practice because the bill also legislates for that. And we heard in committee that the Scottish Government already had powers to do this, but the bill extends those powers and indeed puts pressure on the Scottish Government to use them, because it was 2010 that the last code of practice that exists was updated. But Christine Graham was quite clear that that code of practice was unwieldy and far too long, and that the one under her bill would be much more user-friendly and educational rather than punitive. But a number of those giving evidence, such as the SSPCA, had thought that it would be better and more simple to keep to one code. Yes.
Christine Graham.
Thank you very much. My concern, apart from the, I consider it unwieldy, the existing code, and that it's directed to people who already have a dog, is I don't think many people actually read it. And I'd be interested if the government can tell me if they've any data on how many people actually have read that particular code, whereas mine is so short and has to be read, and you have to sign a certificate saying you've actually read it along with the person transferring the dog to you before you get the dog.
Rhoda Grant.
I absolutely take that on board, but I think there is a way that we could maybe simplify that to get to the place that Christine Graham wants us to go, that people read it, take it on board and indeed act on it. And if they don't, and Colin Smith mentioned this in his speech, should there be penalties for breach? Should there be better enforcement of current regulations? And I think we maybe need to see that going forward. Again, there was discussion about pets and working dogs, and Christine Graham said in her opening in this debate that she was considering extending this to working dogs as well. We all know that people want to buy working dogs that will do a job for them and will take much more care to do that. But again, if there's a loophole created where people can opt to say that this was a working dog and didn't need to be registered, then that is an issue. And I don't believe that anyone would have to take more action if they were buying a working dog, if they had to also fulfil the needs of this bill, because they would already be taking those actions to make sure that they were getting a dog fit for purpose. Presiding officer, there was agreement that the bill, and indeed any subsequent and publicity, would raise awareness, and that in itself is a very positive outcome. But we need to deal with the illegal traders that go to great lengths to cover their tracks. And I would ask the Minister, who said in his opening remarks that this wouldn't stop the illegal trade, would he work to strengthen this bill? And I urge him to do so, to stop that trade.
Thank you, Ms Grant. I now call on Rachel Hamilton to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Ms Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, and I congratulate Christine Graham on successfully bringing the bill to Parliament at last. We are, as we've heard today, a nation of dog lovers. I have three myself. I take great pride in them. I take great enjoyment from them. However, I could not choose which one I would bring to the Holyrood Dog of the Year, so I choose not to enter because it's just unfair. They're all too gorgeous. In our naivety, we believe that dogs are purchased with thought and care, that no one would buy a puppy that was from a disreputable breeder. However, that is not the case, as we've heard today, and the examples that we've heard from colleagues. Bad practice has been demonstrated during the COVID pandemic, where demand outstripped supply. And that was a point raised by my colleague, Maurice Golden. He said that it's the demand for dogs that gives the unscrupulous breeders an opportunity to exploit. And this has led to, as we know, animal abandonment and a crisis in the rescue sector. However, to tackle this, many members in animal welfare charities recognise that the issue lies with awareness or a lack of it, according to the PDSA. And I would question why this may be effective if and needed, if, as the Minister says, the Scottish Government campaign so far in terms of awareness has been so successful. Furthermore, Rhoda Grant said that we might be able to help potential owners identify a rogue dealer, something we desire, but perhaps through the lens of this bill may not be achievable. Jamie Halker-Johnson highlighted that some dog owners may find that they cannot provide the right care for dogs. And as described by my colleague Edward Mountain, an informed dog owner and breeder, that it is essential for the happiness of animals to ensure that the dog owners know what they're doing. Colin Smith raised the similar issues in terms of the lack of understanding of owners. So it is a really, really important part of the bill. Part one would deal with the knowledge gaps, but the committee noted that the questions pertaining to that code shouldn't be on the face of the bill, something that clearly needs to be fleshed out. So, as highlighted by Edward Mountain, part two of the bill is also problematic, and I agree with the Minister, Gillian Martin, and our own Stage 1 committee report that this part of the bill should be removed at the next stage. The report specifically notes concerns around the workability and the enforcement costs of the proposed registration scheme, as highlighted by a number of local authorities and others, and well as the uncertainty about the length of delay before the registration scheme would be introduced. But, on the other hand, I do welcome Christine Graham's commitment and she's open to exploring alternative approaches to improving traceability. And her suggestion of a centralised database of microchip data is one that I will follow with interest, and I know that my colleagues will do that too. Presiding Officer, an important caveat noted in the Stage 1 report in relation to this alternative approach is the need for it to be done collaboratively with the UK administration or government, as Christine Graham has highlighted herself. Turning back to the code itself, I would welcome further discussion on the inclusion of the proposed code into the existing 2010 Code of Practice for the Welfare of Dogs. We discussed this in committee at length. Incorporating the proposed code into the existing one would minimise any potential confusion to the public, as referred to by the convener of the Rural Affairs Committee, Finlay Carson. And moreover, as noted in the Stage 1 committee report, in relation to a concern raised by the Scottish SPCA, incorporated into the existing code would also provide for more practical enforcement in relation to animal welfare investigations. Christine Graham said that she believes a new code will somehow transgress the issues of the current code, which, as she says, there is little awareness. But how will a certificate, which is a piece of paper, actually become enforceable? Is that practical? These are all the questions that we do need to flesh out during the Stage 2 process.
Yes. Finlay Carson.
Thank the member for taking my intervention. I wonder if you share my concerns that a piece of paper could potentially lead to giving an illegal puppy breeder a credibility. And how do we get around, you know, a fact, a piece of paper? If there's not the enforcement behind it, they could lead to people believing they're dealing with someone who's reputable, and that's not the case.
Rachel Hamilton.
Yes, I do think that it has the potential for the certificate to be open to abuse, and I'm yet to be convinced that a piece of paper is going to tackle the illegal puppy dealers and rogue traders, and I'm really concerned about that because we don't want... Well, and the other thing is, of course, is that, you know, they could be... they could get fake copies of these certificates. We just don't know how this is going to pan out. Yes, yes.
Christine Graham?
By no means, I think we're going down a rabbit hole with this, by no means do I say that the piece of paper will prevent illegal puppy breeding. What it does is it ensures it's the public who will prevent it. That's the whole thrust of this. I use the term policing by the public. So if the public are aware, having read the code before you get a puppy, checking it, seeing it with his mother, they are policing it. The piece of paper only says that they have read the code and understand it. It's to reinforce and make them take time. But what will make an impact, I hope, is the public doing it, because that's who we must rely on. Because trying to stop supply when the legislation is beyond us in air and zone has not been working.
Rachel Hamilton.
Christine Graham's absolutely right. What has been in place hasn't been working, but Jim Fairley said that the awareness campaign has been successful. So I don't understand how this awareness campaign can be more successful than the last awareness campaign, although that, of course, is something we want to achieve. But to close, presiding officer, this bill does represent a valuable opportunity to provide greater protections for improved welfare standards for dogs, and the Scottish Conservatives will be delighted to support Christine Graham and her general principles of this bill at stage one. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Hamilton. I now call on Jim Fairley to respond on behalf of the Scottish Government. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to hear that there is such broad support across the Chamber for the general principles of this bill, which, of course, we share. There's undoubtedly many interrelated issues regarding responsible breeding, access to and acquiring of puppies and dogs, and the commitment to care for it throughout its whole life, and how we can help the public to make those informed choices going forward. Now, the bill does not attempt to solve all of these issues, but it does raise the importance of behaviour change in tackling many of these issues. It will take time, engagement with educational resources and effective public awareness. There is merit in creating additional and up-to-date resources alongside a long-term plan dedicated to achieving this vital behavioural change towards dog ownership as a whole. As we have seen and discussed, it is imperative we invest in public awareness campaigns to encourage engagement and ensure responsible dog ownership is at the front of people's minds. And to answer the point that Rachel Hamilton was just making, the figures that we have for the previous campaigns are very good, but we need to continue to reiterate that it's not a standalone piece of work. And I've got to say, anyone could be caught out. Yes, I will take an
intervention. Rachel Hamilton.
I thank Jim Fairley for taking the intervention. Has the government considered, although Christine Graham, who is the architect of this bill, does not want this, considered bringing the codes together or reviewing the current code to make it easier and simpler?
Minister.
Where we're looking at the moment with Christine Graham is what's the best way forward to either make that code to interlink with the previous code that's there. That we're very open to working to find out the best possible solution to make sure that this actually works. And the point I was going to make was anyone can get caught out with this. I've been working with dogs my entire life. But I was determined I was going to buy myself a red beardy pup, and I couldn't get one anywhere. I tried to breed one for years, couldn't get one. And eventually I saw an advert in the paper for a red beardy collie pup down in the Borders. And I jumped in the car with my daughter, big mistake, drove down to the Borders to look at this red beardy pup, which was supposed to be a working pup from a farm, but it was in a council house estate. And the girl gave me the story that it was from her father-in-law's farm he'd been very ill and the dog hadn't been looked after, and the dog wasn't well. And my daughter says, we can't leave that here, Dad. And it's that point. Don't go and look at the pup if you're not, because once you look at it, you're going to buy it. And it's one of these things about head over heart and heart over head. So these are issues that anybody can get caught out with. And we ended up spending thousands of pounds on that pup and eventually had it put down. So we've all got a responsibility to set the highest standards and ensure that we can do everything within our power to educate the breeders, the sellers, the owners, and more importantly, the prospective owners on how to meet the dog's needs and to make sure they're buying it from a reliable source. To fulfil that part, we have in what is shared responsibility towards dogs, Scotland's dogs, and most importantly, showing solidarity and government support to the organisations such as the SSPCA and the Dogs Trust, who interact with the public daily, working relentlessly to improve responsible dog ownership and to tackle the illegal puppy trade. Now, we know in the past year there has been a lot of concern with the UK Government announced the ban on the XL bully dogs. And the Scottish Government is committed to deed not breed, but unfortunately we had to follow the UK legislation and we don't want to find ourselves in that position again. So I'd like to announce that my Minister for Victims and Community Safety, Siobhan Brown, and I will be holding a Responsible Dog Ownership and Control Summit on the 26th of June of this year. And the summit will provide a first-hand opportunity for us to hear from stakeholders dealing with the various aspects of dog ownership and control within our communities, providing an opportunity for a free exchange of ideas within a focused environment to discuss how the current laws and approach on dangerous and out-of-control dogs is operating and what further measures are needed to improve public safety and, of course, continue to improve the welfare of dogs. Yes, I will.
Finlay Carson.
I appreciate Minister giving away. And, you know, we've relied on Christine Graham bringing forward legislation in the past, whether that's control of dogs, and we've now got welfare of dogs. In your discussions, will you consider bringing forward a consolidation bill that would look at pulling all these different bits of legislation together? Because at the BVA dinner last night, some of the discussion was around there's far too many bits of legislation. We could have my colleague Maurice Golden bringing forward and something on electric shock collars, or my colleague previously bringing forward legislation on pet shops. So would that be something that you could consider to bring all these pieces of legislation together to actually start to work for the benefit of the welfare of dogs?
And through the chair, please, Minister. Yep.
The point that Finlay Carson makes is absolutely very well made, and one of the reasons that we want to bring together this round table is for exactly that, to look at what the legislation is. Is it too cluttered, and is there a room just now for us to be able to bring it all together? So with that in mind, Presiding Officer, I will close by saying that we are committed with Christine Graham and the committee and the Scottish Government's next steps to fulfil the responsibility of making sure dog welfare is at the heart of what we do. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. And I now call on Christine Graham to wind up the debate. Ms Graham.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. If I may, I'll comment on one or two of the contributions made in the Chamber. Some I've already done. In relation to the types of dog the Bill should apply to, my initial preference would have been for the Code and the Certificate to only apply to dogs intended to be pets. But the Committee's scrutiny has highlighted, as I've said before, a potential loophole. On that basis, I'm seriously considering to amend the Bill at Stage 2 so the Code and Certificate covers all dogs. On publicity, raised by Arianna Burgess, I couldn't agree more with the committee's clear view that the public awareness that accompanies this bill will be absolutely vital. I've pressed the government for years to treat members' bills with the same degree of serious publicity commitment as they do their own. That's why I've estimated funding for an initial sizeable campaign and then follow-up work in future years to come to raise awareness. After all, if the Parliament passes a member's bill as it passes a government's bill, they are acts of the Scottish Parliament and they deserve to be treated equally. On the certificate, this is a matter which is evidential. I beg your pardon. Yes.
Rachel Hamilton.
From what Christine Graham's saying, Christine Graham is filling a void of something that is needed but not getting the backup and support in terms of the government's commitment to the awareness. So if you didn't bring this forward, would you be happy that the government consolidated some of the animal welfare legislation and gave it, as you say, the backing and support that they could for the public awareness campaign?
Through the chair, please, Kristen Gray.
Well, I'm obviously not going to give an off-the-cuff response to that, but something worth considering. I mean, as a solicitor, I saw much consolidated legislation in my lifetime. It was very useful. On the certificate, I have to say this is simply evidential. And can I gently suggest to Edward Mountain that he checks with Mrs Mountain where their marriage certificate is and the children's birth certificates? I'm sure his wife will know if he doesn't. You can intervene if you like, Mr. Mountain. I want to stand by my comment, I believe, in a separate code. And I will refer here, actually, to the committee's Stage 1 report at paragraph 45. The majority of the committee agrees with Christine Graham that a standalone, concise and accessible code of practice relating to the acquisition of dogs would seem more likely to engage and therefore inform prospective dog acquirers than incorporating the proposed code into the existing 36-page 2010 code, Game, Set and Match. On the other matters of it, on some of the core criticisms of the contents of the code being on the face of the bill, I stand by my view. The elements of the code that I set out actually will stand the test of time. They're just the questions that anybody who's a good owner and a prospective owner asks themselves. The bill allows for more content to be added to the code over and above these points. Of course, I appreciate the Committee of the Government consider this approach to be unusual, or as Sir Humphrey would have said, reference yes, Minister, these are courageous. And the Government has indicated it will seek to amend the bill in this regard. But I will consider the purpose and effect of these amendments closely in advance of deciding my position at Stage 2. Now, as earlier intimated in my opening speech, I support the removal of Part 2, but with this caveat that meaningful work is undertaken, a UK-wide single portal for microchipping information. And I'm delighted to tell the Chamber that I was communicating with DEFRA, and on the 11th of March, I wrote a lovely letter back from Lord Douglas Miller, who is Secretary of State, about UK-wide dog microchipping database dated 15th April. And I'm happy to share this letter with members because this is collegiate, this is collective. There's no point, in my view, in having a portal just for Scotland. It's good to have on a UK-wide basis. So they did a huge consultation. In a quote, we have recently published our response to this consultation, which is available at, and it gives you the link, in which we committed to introducing a single point of search portal. My officials will be discussing with their counterparts in the devolved administrations the scope to devolve the portal on a UK basis. I think this is good news for animal welfare and dog welfare in particular. The planned reforms will improve traceability by requiring information on the dog breeder to remain as a permanently accessible part of the microchip record, as well as requiring a dog's first keeper to supply the microchip number of the puppy's mother. This information will remain permanently accessible for enforcement purposes. And it goes on. I don't want to spend too much time, I know it's late in the day, but it's a really positive letter, and I do hope that the UK Government, the Scottish Government, Welsh and Northern Ireland will collaborate on this. Just think of the difference it would make. In one respect, even to the illegal, and I call them puppy factory farms. It's an insult to call them farms. They're factory farms. They're factories. But if we can deal with that, and we have a database that applies to Northern Ireland as well, we might be getting somewhere. Now, finally, I want to say, as other members have mentioned their dogs, I have to conclude with my own fond memories of my long-lost and long-gone dog, Roosty. She was a wonderful, loving Irish setter from a puppy that came from a gamekeeper's setter. They had a litter, and of course, he didn't need all the puppies. It was in Twynham. I make reference to Galloway here because I lived here at the time, and we took it back to Old Minigaff. It was the gamekeeper that said, "Come on, I'll show you the puppy's mother." Yes, I was a novice at this. She was a wonderful dog, and best of all, she taught me how to be a good owner, because you learn a lot from your dog. I'm not going to get emotional. I refuse to be emotional, but I've still got her collar and her leash 40 years later. I've still got a picture of her upstairs beside my computer, because the bonds that you make with these animals, whether it's one or a succession of dogs or whatever, they are there forever. And I want all puppies and dogs like yours and like Roosty to have the kind of life she had right from the beginning, right till I had to, at the end of the day, which is part of owning the dog, is to have her life ended peaceably. So, assuming the general principles of the bill are agreed, I look forward to line-by-line consideration of the committee by the committee at Stage 2. And let's do something, please, to ensure that we have a good relationship with owners and their puppies, and we stop illegal factory farming as best we can. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill at Stage 1. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of Motion 13131 in the name of Shirley-Ann Somerville on appointments of the Chair and Commissioners of the Poverty and Inequality Commission. And I call on Shirley-Ann Somerville to move the motion. Cabinet Secretary.
Formally moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And the question on this motion will be put at decision time. And I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now. And I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. And the question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. And there are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that Motion 13129, in the name of Richard Lockhead, on Legislative Consent Motion, Data Protection and Digital Information Bill, UK legislation, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Can I just confirm we are all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. The motion is therefore agreed. The next question is that Motion 12991, in the name of Christine Graham, on Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill at Stage 1, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And the final question is that Motion 13131, in the name of Shirley-Ann Somerville, on appointments of the Chair and Commissioners of the Poverty and Inequality Commission, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed, and that concludes decision time, and I close this meeting.